Hi everyone, I welcome you for today's lecture on gantry girder. It will be design of a gantry girder with necessary checks. What do you mean by that? These are the structures which is built in industrial buildings. It is used to carry the load and heavy equipment inside the industrial building. This gantry girder, which consists of a runway beam. So this is an I section. So the I section runs throughout the length of the building. So up to which distance you have to travel the heavy load. And next, end truck bumper, and you will be having bridge drive wheel. So these wheels are used to drive the structure. So you will be having two wheels at the two end. So due to this wheel, this crane will be transported from one end to another end. You can see the movement. So there will be wheels inside the crane, and you can see the conductor track. So these are the track which is also on the other side. So this is conductor track. By this track you could be able to transfer the weight from the size. See, the load and the equipment can be transferred to any of this dimension in its length or in its width. So this is the usefulness of the structure. You will be having a hook block or a crab, so you can hang the loads and you can drag to the distance, or there will be a crab like structure. It will catch the load or equipment and it can transfer to all the area throughout this. And you can see a rails. So above that there will be a runway rail. So I section is being placed here, and above that you will be having a rail. Through this rail line, crane girder moves towards the length. So this is called as crane girder or bridge girder. Okay, now you understood the components of the gantry girder system. We will be designing the I section. So this is the structure which is going to transfer the load. See, whatever load is taken by this hook, it will be transferred to the two girders. So these are the crane structure which will be hanging. So through this crane, there will be half of the load will be transferred to this girder and another half of the load will be transferred to this gantry girder. This is crab girder and this is the gantry girder. So you find the difference. So right now we are going to design this gantry girder structure, which will be an I section, and above that, if required to increase the size of the member or the sectional property, you can add another member. It is a channel member. Above that you will be having a rail, and the wheels will be rolling through this rail, and you will be having a long structure called girder. So this is known as the crab girder, and you can see the hoist, crab or trolley. Gantry girders are provided in industrial buildings to support the overhead cranes. So these are also called overhead cranes for transporting and lifting heavy loads. These cranes may be manually operated or electrically operated. This gantry girder is being horizontally supported. You can see, if any wheel is loading horizontally, this load can be transferred by this horizontal connection. So at the bottom you are having the gantry girder connection. At the top also you are having stability for both vertical load and horizontal load. So this is the difference here, and you will be having a column. So this load will be transferred to this column by using a corbel, and it will transfer the load to a column, and the column transfer the load to the foundation. This is a single wheel. So you can visually understand there will be a rail which is similar to the railway lines, and you will be having a wheel over it. So due to that, you will be having a lateral load. Okay. And let us look into the what are all the analytical points. So you can understand this as a column, and you are having another column. In between that, you are having a span. This span is known as span of the gantry girder. Two crab girder, which will be transferring the hoist towards the lateral direction. So it transfer in this direction. What will happen? So due to this movement, there will be a load which is acting called lateral load or horizontal load. And also the wheels are placed above this girder. So here you will be having a gantry girder, and above that the wheels will be moving towards the length, and this is in the width direction. So in the width direction you will be having a lateral load, and in the length direction you will be having a longitudinal thrust. So these are the other two forces apart from the vertical load. So whatever load you are carrying through this girder will be one type of load, which is called wheel load. So and another two type of load is lateral load and longitudinal thrust. So these are the other two loads which is acting in the gantry girder. So this is the difference between a plate girder and gantry girder. So in plate girder, majority of the loads will be vertical. You will be not having horizontal load. These loads will be taken care by the joint between the bridges. Then what about gantry girder? So this is a special structure. You will be having moment in both the direction, in horizontal way as well as the vertical way. Hence this is a different type of structure. If the structure is being operated manually, then 10% of maximum static wheel load should be added in addition for impact load. So there will be some impact load due to the movement. So whenever you are having a dynamic load, so due to this dynamic load you will be having some impact in the structure. So if it is manually operated, you can assume 10%. If it is electrically operated cranes, you can add 25% of the load as impact load. And what about this? So this is the vertical forces. So whatever load you are getting, you have to add this 25 or 10% according to your mode of transportation. And what about horizontal forces? So you are having a horizontal load in one direction, in the lateral direction. So this is known as lateral force. When EOT crane are used, that is electrically operated traveling, you can assume 10% of weight of crab and weight lifted on the crane. So and if MOT cranes are used, 5% of the weight of crab and weight lifted on the crane. So the self weight of this crab or this hook can be added plus the weight which is carried. So two things you have to add, and by summing that one you have to add additional 5% to the load. And what about the horizontal force along longitudinal direction? That is 4% of static wheel load. So while arriving the forces, you have to take this into consideration to arrive the total load. Okay. This crab will be operated towards the lateral direction. In this direction, if we apply brake, there will be a load which is caused, and in other term it is called a braking load, so which will be a lateral force. And in longitudinal side also you will be having the same load. In other terms, is lateral load is known as surge load and longitudinal load is called braking load. So these are the other terms while solving a problem. So what are the loads which is acting in a gantry girder? Is the vertical reaction from the load on the crane girder, so which is due to the crab dead weight and the load which is hanged, and the longitudinal force due to starting and stopping of the crane. So the crane will run towards the longitudinal side. So due to the start and stop operation, you will be having that longitudinal force, and lateral force will be due to start and stopping of the crab. So the crab will be moving in the longitudinal direction. So due to this operation, while starting and stopping, you will be have crab load, and additionally impact load will be there, and finally fatigue effect. Okay, so these are the forms of gantry girder. This is used for different application, and for each and every application in harbors it may be used. This semi type of gantry girder, one side it will be loaded with the column and other side it will be loaded in the wall, and overhead traveling. These are the different types of gantry girders, and you can see according to the load which is being taken. So this section or the member has to be built up. So these are all known as built up section, which is A, B, C, D. So if the load is higher, this section is not enough. So the only high section of gantry girder is not enough, so that the plates are added. So according to the type of load, you can add a channel section or double angle section. So these are double angles which are provided at both top and bottom, and double I section. So this is a built up section by using double I section along with the angle section. So according to the requirement, you can assume the member. Okay, the next thing what you have to understand is the load will be moving type load in the span. When you are having a span of gantry girder, there will be loads. So you will be having wheels running around the girder. So what will happen? There will be two wheels. So by these two wheels, the total load is going to transfer in this girder. So what happens? The mode of load will be moving load. So in plate girders, you will be considering dead load into account, and you can derive the bending moment and shear force through this dead load. And in case of gantry girders, the load will be moving load. So for that, there are certain principles to get the shear force and bending moment. So if you want maximum shear force and bending moment, these wheels has to be located at a particular distance from the support in order to get the maximum bending moment and maximum shear force. So in order to get that, we shall follow the principle. So if you need maximum shear force, what you have to do is you have to locate the two wheel load at the edge of the span. So if the wheel loads are very near to the support, then you will be having the maximum shear force. So if you need in terms of a formula, you can take W as wheel load and 2C is the distance between the two wheel, and L is the span. So you can use this formula in order to find the shear force and reaction. So the same picture is given here. So if you need bending moment, maximum bending moment, there are two cases. In this picture you can see if A by L, so this is A, the distance between the wheels, and L is the span. Say for example, if this is 8 meter, you can exactly place the first wheel load at 4 meter and the other distance will be A. And what happens if A by L ratio is lesser than 0.586? So in this case it is greater than or equal, and in this case it will be less than or equal to 0.586. What you have to do is, see, this is the center point of the span. So if this is 8 meter, the center point C will be exactly at 4 meter. So the distance between the two wheel load is 4 meter. Say for example, the center between the two wheel will be 2 meter. So at 2 meter, there will be a resultant load. So what do you mean by resultant is, if you add the two load, you will be having the resultant load and the resultant distance. So if you need maximum bending moment, what you have to do is, you have to place the wheel at a distance a by 4 from the center. So this is the center of the span. You have to place this two wheel. So a is the distance between the wheel, and you have to place the resultant load at the distance of a by 4. So the same formula is given here, which is c by 4. What do you mean by c is distance between the two wheel. So if you want maximum bending moment, you can take, you can locate the wheel load at c by 4 distance. The first wheel should be placed at the distance of c by 4. So these are the two cases. If you need maximum shear force and maximum bending moment, you can use this guideline. Okay, by this understanding, let us get into a design. Design a crane gantry to carry a electric overhead traveling crane. So this is EOT for an industrial building to suit the following data. So now the data is given here. The crane load lifting capacity is 200 kilonewton. So the load will be carried, which will be 200. This is the maximum load which will be carried by the hook or the crab. And the next weight is the crane girder excluding trolley. So there will be a trolley weight. So the crane of the girder, you will be having two crane girder. You can see that. So this is crane girder. So you will be having two number of crane girder. So this is crane girder 1 and crane girder 2. So this weight is is 200 kilonewton, and weight of trolley, motor, hook, etc. So you will be having a trolley above the crane girder. So this trolley self weight and the crane hook, so the load is given as 40 kilonewton, and distance between centers of gantry rail. So this is one gantry rail and this is another gantry rail. So the distance between the two gantry rail is 15 meter, and the gantry girder span is given as 7.5. And you can understand this is 15 meter and span of the gantry girder is 7.5, and minimum approach of crane hook is 1.2 meter. So this is known as the minimum approach. So this trolley cannot go to the extreme point. So you will be having a minimum approach. So this approach is 1.2. After 1.2, the crane will be stopping to this end, same at the opposite end. So at 1.2 distance, the crane trolley will be stopping. So this is known as minimum of crane hook. So the distance between the crane wheels, so you will be having a crane girder and the second crane girder, the distance between the two crane girder is 3.5 meter distance. Okay, so now the weight of the rail section is given as 0.3 kilonewton per meter. We already know that you will be having a rail. So this is the structure which we are going to design. So the rail is having a self weight of 0.3 kilonewton per meter, which will be running above the girder, and the height of the rail section will be 150 mm, that is 0.15 meter, and yield stress of steel is given as 250 newton per mm square. Now what we have to do is draw the cross section of gantry girder to a suitable scale. Design should conform to the specification of Indian standard codes. We have to design and draw the cross section of the gantry girder. So our aim is to design this section. So whatever the load which is acting will be transferred through this gantry girder to the column. So let us start the design. by arriving the load. So while designing, first thing what we have to do is we have to arrive the load, what are all the loads acting, and second thing will be finding the shear force and bending moment, what is the maximum shear and bending moment, and after that you will be checking for shear force and bending. So if it is acceptable, you can have other serviceability checks also. Yes, let us start the design. The crane girder is having a load of 200 kilonewton, which is in total they have given. So if you need in terms of meter, if you convert into a UDL, you can divide 240 divided by 15. So like that. And second thing is 240 kilonewton. So what is this 240 is the weight which is being carried by the crab, and the dead load of the crab, the motor. So if you add that, you will be having a point load which will be running towards the crane girder. Okay, so this is 240 kilonewton. What we can do is the span of the gantry girder is 7.5. So maximum static wheel due to self weight of the crane girder. So let us make into a single load. So how to convert that? So you will be having two wheels. See, this is crane girder number 1 and crane girder number 2, and there will be 1, 2, 3, 4, there will be 4 wheels which is acting in a both the girder. So if you want to find wheel load for a single wheel, you can divide it by 4. So 200 divided by 4, you will be getting 50 kilonewton. So maximum static wheel load due to self weight of crane girder. So we have identified that. And second thing is maximum static wheel load due to crane load is computed as, so the crane will be carrying 200 kilonewton load plus the 40 kilonewton self weight of the crab hook, etc. So if you add that, and the minimum distance will be 1.2, so let us subtract with 15 meter. So if you divide this by 2 into 15, you will be getting a single wheel load. So the single wheel load will be 110 kilonewton. Okay, we have identified a single wheel load. So what to do after that? The total load on a gantry girder due to weight of crane and crane load. So right now we know the crane load is 110 and the self weight of the crane is 50. So if you add that, you will be getting 160 kilonewton per wheel. So a single wheel will be carrying 160 kilonewton, and this side of the wheel will be carrying 160. Same for the next side. Okay. Then there will be additional load due to the impact. So we already gone through that. Due to this load, what will happen? Electrically operated overhead traveling, that is EOT crane, you can add 25%. So 160 into 1.25, we are increasing 25%, so the load will be 200 kilonewton. Okay, now we have derived the total load. So after that, let us find the factored load. We are multiplying 1.5 as the factored load. So the final load for the design calculation will be 200 into 1.5 is 300 kilonewton. So per wheel, 300 kilonewton of force will be transferring. We will assume this and let us proceed the design. Right now we have found 300 kilonewton of vertical load which is acting. This is the design load. Okay, what about the lateral surge load and longitudinal braking load? So I already discussed that there will be lateral and longitudinal load. So you can Take 10% of crab hook plus crab loads divided by 4. So the total load will be 200 plus 40. If you divide this by 4, and 10% of that will be 0.1. So you will be having 6 kilonewton. So after factoring this, you will be having 9 kilonewton. So in lateral direction, see, so this is the lateral direction. In lateral direction, you will be having this load. Then this load, we have identified as 9 kilonewton. So 9 kilonewton of force will be acting in this girder. So next we will be identifying the longitudinal load. So what is the force which is acting in this direction? So for that, 5% of V load is being given as per IS code recommendation 875 and 807. So if it is a 5% of V load is 200, and if you multiply that, 10 kilonewton will be acting. So if you factor that, you will be having a longitudinal force of 15 kilonewton. So right now we have arrived all the forces which is acting in the girder. So a vertical force, horizontal force in lateral as well as the longitudinal. After arriving this, we can find the bending moment and shear force. How to find the bending moment and shear force? Similarly, the same way for vertical moment, lateral moment and longitudinal moment due to this three load. So we shall split it into three and we shall identify the bending moment. So as discussed earlier, if you want maximum bending moment, so the span of the girder will be 7.5 meter, that is 7500 mm. So the maximum wheel load is 300 kilonewton and the distance between the wheel will be 3.5 meter. And if you need maximum bending moment, so you can check the ratio of C by L. So this is lesser than 0.5. So the condition which I gave you earlier, which is 3.5 by 7.5 will be 0.467. So this is lesser than this. So A by L, this condition. So if you need to identify the bending moment, you can place your wheel load at a distance of A by 4. So A here for our case is 3.5 divided by 4. You will be proceeding with the same condition. Okay, 3.5 divided by 4 will be 0.875. So at 0.875 we will be placing the first wheel. Now you can find the bending moment at the center. How to find the bending moment? First you have to find the reaction at A and B. If you are taking moment at B, say for example, if you want to find that, RA plus RB will be 600. So total downward force is 600 and total upward force is RA and RB. To find RB, you can take moment at RA. So we are taking moment at RA, RB into distance will be 7.5 and 300 into 6.375. and 300 into 2.875. So if you resolve this, you will be getting RB equal to 370 kilonewton, and if you substitute RB here, you will be getting RA as 230 kilonewton. So right now you know RB and RA. You can find the bending moment at the center. So while taking moment at the center, what we can do is we can look into the right hand side, RB into distance. So the distance will be 3.75. The center is at the distance of 3.75. So RB into 3.75. So that is 370 into 3.75, which will be anti-clockwise, and 300 into 2.625. will be clockwise. So it will be plus of this value. If you add that, you will be getting 600 kilonewton meter. So this is the maximum moment at the center. So this is the maximum load due to moving wheel. So what about bending moment due to dead load? So what do you mean by this? Dead load is assuming the self weight of gantry girder. So this 300 kilonewton is a wheel load which is acting. So you are having the girder which also has the self weight which runs throughout the span. So you can find the self weight as, by assuming the self weight of gantry girder as 1.7 kilonewton per meter. So this assumption will be clarified further. And the self weight of rail is given as 0.3 kilonewton per meter in the given data. And you can add this, and if you add 1.7 plus 0.3, you will be getting 2 into 1.5 for factoring, you will be getting 3 kilonewton per meter. So while finding the bending moment, you can find WL square divided by 8. So load is 3 and L is 7.5 square divided by 8. So you will be getting 21 kilonewton. So this is the bending moment. So you can add 600 plus this 21. The total moment will be 621 kilonewton meter, which is the vertical bending moment. Yes, next let us discuss the horizontal bending moment. So this bending moment is due to the surge load, and you will be having a 9 kilonewton, which you have arrived earlier in the lateral direction. You can see in the lateral direction a 9 kilonewton of surge load we have arrived. So for this load, you will be taking the structure. So this will be, while taking the surge load, you can take the same concept of the finding maximum bending moment and shear force. So instead of 300 kilonewton, you can place the 9 kilonewton at the same place to find the maximum horizontal bending moment, that is surge moment. So if you resolve this, Ra plus Rb will be 18. So taking moment at point A, you will be getting the maximum bending moment as 18 kilonewton meter at the center. So you have to follow the same procedure for vertical what we have arrived. So the next thing is moment due to drag force. So the drag force what we arrived is 15 kilonewton. The rail which is above the gantry girder, what is the distance? The height of the rail is 0.15 and the eccentricity is 0.3. So which I will explain the 0.3. So if you add that, you will be getting 0.45. And after multiplying with the load which we arrived, so 15 into 0.45 divided by 7.5. So will be the reaction, which is 0.9 kilonewton. So after getting this 0.9 kilonewton, this is a reaction due to the drag force. Okay, so due to this load, you will be having 2 point load at the same places. So instead of 9 kilonewton, the bending moment condition is same. You can provide 0.9 kilonewton and follow the same process. You will be getting a bending moment of 1.8 kilonewton meter. Okay, after getting this moment, there are three moment which is due to vertical and due to horizontal load and lateral load. So if you add the three loads and if you add the three moment, you will be getting 621 plus 18 plus 1.8. So the total design bending moment will be 641 kilonewton meter. And the same way you can find the shear force. The condition here is, you have to find the shear force by placing the load which is near to the support. So we have 300 kilonewton wheel load and a distance of 3.5. So if you place here, you have to find the reaction first for this condition. And if we are finding that, so total RA plus RB should be 300 plus 300 will be 600. So this is sum of V equal to 0. And if you apply the condition sum of M equal to 0 and find the moment, what will happen? I am taking the point A, and from the point A, RB into distance will be 7.5 and 300 into 3.5. So if you find the answer for this, so you will get RB. So RB will be 140 kilonewton, and if you substitute here, you will be getting RA as 460. So to find shear force, you can find the shear force from the extreme. What we need is, we need the shear force at point A. So you are having RB as 140, which will be minus, and you are having two load of 300 plus 300. So the remaining shear force will be 460 kilonewton, which is acting at the point A. So this will be the maximum shear force for this vertical load. The same way you have to follow for the lateral and the longitudinal force. So if you follow the same process, you will be getting shear force of 13.8 kilonewton and 1.38 kilonewton. So if you add all the three values, you will be getting the total shear force as 475 kilonewton. So currently we have identified the maximum bending moment as 641 kilonewton meter and maximum shear force as 475 kilonewton. So let us proceed the preliminary design. So in this preliminary design, we will be identifying the sectional detail as per the guideline. Okay. So in order to arrive at economical depth for gantry girder, for plate girder, you would have used a different formula. For economical purpose in gantry girder, so majorly you can use the rolled steel section. So in plate girders, you will be not using this conventional section. So for this condition, you can use the economical depth formula as span by 12. So approximately 7500 is our length, divided by 12, you will be getting 625 mm. So this will be the economical depth. We can assume near to this value. So around 600, you are having a section. ISWB we will be using of 600, and also approximate width of the girder, you can use span by 30, that is 7500 by 30 will be 250. So exactly for 600 and the width of 250, you are having a section. So that we will discuss. For gantry girder supporting crane of capacity up to 500 kilonewton, the maximum deflection should not exceed the ratio of span by 750. This is the deflection criteria. So in table 6 of IS 800, you are having a deflection limit for different structure and different load. So for industrial building, right now we are designing, and for vertical load, you can take crane operated electrically. Right now we are designing for this condition. So up to 50 ton, right now we are designing 20 ton. So you can take this condition. The gantry crane should be having a maximum deflection limit of span by 750. So we will be following this guideline. If it is over 50 ton, you can take span by 1000. Okay. While taking that, this is an expression for getting the maximum deflection at the midpoint. So if you are having two loads, by this two load, you will be having a deflection at the center. Let us find the maximum deflection condition to arrive a certain moment of inertia. that is I. We need a capital I condition in order to proceed the next step. So the formula here is WA divided by 24EI in bracket 3L square minus 4A square. So if you substitute in this equation, you will be getting the deflection at the center. So W here is the load. Currently we are taking 200 kilonewton load. If you take this and if we are substituting, the A will be the distance, that is 3.5 meter, and E is Young's modulus, which is 2 into 10 power 5, and I we have to identify. So you can cross multiply with the deflection. So we know the deflection should be span divided by 750. So if we divide that, we will be getting a the span is 7500 divided by 750. We have cross multiplied and L is the span, which is 7500, and A is 3000 and A here is 2000. So after substituting all the values in this data, you can find the value of moment of inertia. So we need 1.279 into 10 power 9 mm power 4. So the moment of inertia of our section is required in this amount. So these two things are a guideline. You can see that the depth we arrived is 624, which is an thumb rule. Also the I what we arrived is 1.279 is also a gross identification. Next, let us have a section modulus approximation. And for getting the plastic section modulus, you will be having a equation of 1.4 m divided by fy. So the maximum moment what we got is 641. If we convert in terms of newton mm, you can multiply into 10 power 6 divided by fy is 250, which is the permissible stress in the steel. So if you simplify that, you will be getting 3589 into 10 power 3 mm cube. So this much of plastic section modulus is required. By getting this poor approximation, you can see the plastic modulus ZP I and the overall depth of the girder and the width. By these four criteria, we are coming into a decision that we will be taking a section of ISWB 600, which is in the steel table. So if you go for this section, the self weight here is 133.7 kilogram per meter. So if you need in terms of kilonewton per meter, you can divide it by 100. So we will be getting 1.337 kilonewton per meter. For above that, we can add a channel section ISLC. We can take the self weight of the section will be 33.1 kilogram per meter. So in terms of kilonewton per meter, we can assume it as 0.331 kilonewton per meter. So if you add this, you will be getting 1.7 kilonewton per meter. So this is the total self weight of the gantry girder. So while arriving the load, you can see that we have taken 1.7 as the dead load of the gantry girder. So currently we are matching that by providing two number of sections. So single section is not capable of having the properties as well as the self weight. So plus this 0.3 will be raised. So right now our assumption, earlier assumption also matches. Okay. Then the total area of the combined section will be 17038 plus 4211. So all the sectional properties are here. You can see the sectional area is 170.38 in terms of centimeter square. If you need in terms of mm, So it will be 17038. So the total area in terms of mm is written here. Similarly for the channel section, the area will be 4211 cm². So it will be 4211. So if you add the two area, you will be getting combined area, which is 21249 mm². Okay. The remaining data such as width of the flange, thickness of the flange is and radius of gyration, section modulus for elastic and plastic, everything is given here. Further, we will be taking these two details in order to proceed the design. Okay. Next, we have to find the combined sectional property. See, we know the IXX. We can find IXX, that is moment of inertia of the section in x-axis individually. But what we are doing is we are designing a built-up section which carries a I section as well as the channel section. So in order to get the combined IXX and IYY, we have to do certain calculations. So after finding this calculation, what we need is we have to check for the local moment carrying capacity, that is 1.2 ZTX. So this Z is known as the section modulus at tension side. So the beam has tension and compression side. So the bottom side will be tension and top one will be compression. The load is going to act on the top of the section. So for that you need ZTX. Fy is 250, we already know. And ZPX, what do you mean by PX is plastic section modulus at x-axis. Also you need compression section modulus at x-axis and plastic section modulus at y-axis. So these four parameters are required to check for the combined local moment carrying capacity. It should be lesser than or equal to 1. So for getting this, what we have to do is we have to find the combined sectional property. So how to find the moment of inertia at x-axis and y-axis? So let us proceed. If you know basics or if you want to understand basics, you can check my earlier video about moment of inertia. You can check that and get clarified. So in short, I will be explaining here. If I need combined section modulus, I have to find Y1 and Y2. So this is the capital IXS, which is the combined center of gravity of this built up section. How to find that? We are having, in order to find Y1, the formula is A1 Y1 plus A2 Y2 divided by A1 plus A2. The A1 here is area of the I section and A2 is area of the channel section. I have provided the reference line at the top. So if the reference line is at the top, first area will be this I section. We know the I section area is 17038 into the distance from the top will be, so total distance is 600 and the half will be 300. So above that you are having a channel section which is having the web thickness of 6.7. So if we add 300 plus 6.7 into A1 plus the second section is this channel section which is having area of 4211 and the distance from the individual centroid will be 28.7. So these things are available in sectional properties. You can check the Y distance 2.87 in terms of centimeter. So in terms of meter you can take it as 28.7. So by using this individual centroid you can find the Y1 divided by A1 plus A2. So the distance from the top, that is Y1, will be 251.6. And if you need Y2, you know the total distance is 600 plus the thickness of the web is 6.7, that is 600 and that is 600 plus 6.7 minus 251.6 will be 355.1 meter. So this will be the remaining distance. So right now we have found out the common point of the x-axis. Okay, so if you want total IXX, that is we have identified the centroidal distance. So right now if you need IXX, you have to add IXX of the I section plus IYY of the channel section. Why it is opposite? Why? Because you are not providing the channel section in the own axis. You are inverting the channel section. So that is why this for I section X and Y will be in the same direction, and for channel section, so the X direction will be inverse, X and Y direction will be inverse. So that is why you are adding IXX of beam and IYY of channel in order to find the common IXX. So how to find IXX of beam? You are having a formula of how to find radius of gyration is root of I by A. So R equal to root of I by A. So if you want to find RX, radius of gyration at X, you can substitute IXX divided by area. So we know the radius of gyration of each and every section. You can see the radius of gyration at x-axis and y-axis. For I section is given, and for channel section also Rx and Ry is given. If you want to find moment of inertia, just you have to cross multiply. That is, if you need I, you can square root the radius of variation. So Rx square into area will be the IXX. Okay, if you multiply this, you will be getting 1062 into 10 power 6 mm power 4. For the channel section, that is ISLC of YY. So the radius of gyration at YY is 2.87. So in terms of centimeter, in terms of millimeter, you need 28.7 square into the area. So likewise, if you multiply, and you can get the individual moment of inertia. How to get the combined moment of inertia? What you have to do is, you have to use for IXX plus area into distance square formula. So you are having two sections, so you will be using this formula twice. So for this I section, we know the common IXX will be 1062 into 10 power 6 plus area is, area of I section, we know that 17038 into the distance square. What do you mean by the distance is, we know the common centroid which is acting from the top will be 251.6. You have to minus this by the individual centroid will be 300 plus 6.7. So the total distance will be 306.7. And if you find this, the distance will be 55.1. So you can multiply this and derive the answer. Also for the channel section, channel section you got IYY, and the area of channel section will be 4211 into distance square. So the distance will be from the top, the common centroid will be at 251.6 and the individual centroid will be at 28.7. so if you find the difference and square, you will be getting the answer. That is 113.7 into 10 power 6 will be the total IXX. Okay, let us find the total IYY. The same way, you have to find, you have to add IYY of the beam and IXX of the channel. So the same process for getting IYY, RY into A. So RX into A. For channel section, you have to take the values from the table and you can find the total IYY. Okay, after finding the common moment of inertia, in x and y axis, you have to find ZCX. What do you mean by that? That is section modulus at compression side and section modulus at tension in x axis. So we know the IXX value is 111.3.7 into 10 power 6. And if you need section modulus, the formula is I by Y. So if you need section modulus at top, you can substitute the top distance from the neutral axis. So the top distance will be 251.6 and bottom distance will be 355.1. The IXX will be common. So the answer for compression and tension side section modulus of this gantry girder will be 4426.5 into 10 power 3 and 3137 into 10 power 3. So this is our answer. We got the first thing. This is elastic section modulus. I have written in short of the section totals, total area of this section, moment of inertia at IXX and IYY, and we have found out this two value. Now let us find the ZY at the top flange alone. Why we are finding ZY? So this is ZX and this is ZY. Why we are finding ZY at the top flange alone is, you are having the horizontal force at the top of the gantry girder. At the bottom it is fixed with the section, hence we are only finding the ZY at the top, that is at the compression zone only. Okay, in order to find that, the same way you have to follow these steps. A hint here is, if you want to find ZY of the top flange alone, so the total distance is 300, so the centroid will be, this section is similar along the y axis, so you can take the depth as 150, so total is 300. So the common centroid for I section and channel section will be at 150, hence we are taking 150 here, and we have arrived the I at y axis. So we know the I of y axis will be, for the tension flange you have to use the formula of BD cube divided by 12. So the depth will be 250 cube and the breadth will be 21.3. you can take in the sectional property. After getting this, you can add with the IXX of the channel. So if you add totally, you will be getting moment of inertia at y axis for compression flange alone. So after dividing that, you will be getting ZY of the top flange. So the value is 587829.16. Okay. Computation of plastic modulus. We have found the elastic section modulus at x direction as well as the y direction. Now we are computing the plastic section modulus. Plastic section modulus is, we know the sectional properties. By getting the sectional property, the plastic section modulus can be found out by cutting the area into two equal area half. So the centroid of the section model, plastic section modulus, will be at the place where the area of top and bottom should be half. This is the concept. So how to find half of the area? That is, the area of channel we already know, that is 4211 divided by 2 times 11.2. what do you mean by 11.2 is thickness of the web. So you can get the thickness of the web. Thickness of the web of I section is 11.2. so we are substituting the thickness of the web here as 11.2. so if you divide that, you will be getting the y distance of 188 mm. So this 188 mm will be the distance between the individual centroid and the equal area axis. So this distance right now we have found out. So the plastic section modulus is computed about the axis which divides the area into two equal parts. We know the total area is 21249. If you divide it by 2, you will be getting 12124.5 mm². So this is the half of the area. Okay, after finding this, you can find the section modulus, that is plastic section modulus at x axis. So how to find that? Area into distance. So the area will be, for each and every section, let us find. So 21.3, what do you mean by 21.3 is, this is the thickness of the flange and the width of the flange is 250. So first we shall identify the bottom side of the section modulus. So if you multiply the area, that is 21.3 into 250, which will be the area, and the distance will be, so sum of A into Y. Y is the distance. Right now you know that the total distance of the section is 600, and the individual and the centroid of I section will be at 300. So if you add 300 plus 188, what we arrived earlier, so that is 488. From the bottom at the point of 488 mm, you will be having the equal area axis. So we are subtracting the 488, that is 488 minus 21.3 divided by 2, that is the flange total thickness is 21.3. So if you divide it by 2, you will be getting the centroid of the flange, and the, from the centroid of the flange to the equal area axis. And next you are having the webs section. So the web section total height will be 488 and the thickness will be 11.2. so 488 will be the total height. If you subtract 21.3, you will be getting purely the web of the I section. So 488 minus 21.3 into the web size, the thickness of the web is 11.2, which you can get it from the table. And the centroid of the web will be 488 minus 21.3 divided by 2. So this will be the Y. So if you add this two component, you will be getting the ZPX, that is plastic section modulus at X axis. So bottom part is over. So what about the top section? You are having three component. What are they? A channel section, flange area, and the web area of I section. So three components are there. So let us find equal area axis for the channel section. We know the channel section area is 4211 into what will be the distance from equal area axis. It will be, so you know, out of 606.7, this is the total height, which is 606.7. If you subtract 488, you will get the remaining value as 118.7. so this is the total distance, and if you subtract the individual centroid, so the individual centroid will be 28.7. so the channel section centroid is given as 28.7, and if you subtract, you will be getting area into distance. Okay, next for the flange. So the flange of the I section will be, the total thickness is 250 and the thickness will be 21.3, which is the area, and the distance will be total 118.7. first we have to subtract the channel web thickness, so which is 6.7, and we have to find the center of the thickness of flange. So thickness of flange is 21.3 divided by 2 is 10.65. So after subtracting this, you will be getting the distance from equal area axis to the center of the flange. So the second component is over. What about the third component of the thickness of the web? The area will be 11.2 into 90.7. So what is 90.7? You have to subtract the thickness of the web of channel, which is 6.7 minus 21.3, you will be getting 90.7 into 11.2, which is the thickness, and the area is derived. And if you divide the same 90.7 divided by 2, you will be getting the centroid. So after adding this thing, you will be getting ZPX at the top of this axis. So currently we have identified the ZP at the top and ZP at the bottom. So if you add that, you will be getting total ZPX as 4.754 into 10 power 6 mm power cube for top flange only. Similar way what you have done here, see, we have identified elastic section modulus at x axis at top and bottom, and we have find elastic section modulus at y at the top. Right now the plastic section modulus at top flange only, the same thing you have to follow ZPY, which is for top flange only. We are finding the section modulus at y axis. If you are taking y axis, in order to find the section modulus of the flange section, you are having a direct formula, which is BD square divided by 4. So you can substitute the breadth as 21.3 and depth as 250 square plus. The next section is the channel section. For this channel, you are having breadth as 6.7 and depth as 300 minus 2 into 11.6. So the thickness of the flange is 11.6. If you are neglecting the thickness of the flange, you will get purely the web of the channel. You square that divided by 4, and the next thing is the depth of the flange of channel section is 100. You are having two channel section. So if you multiply that, you will be having 2 into 100 into 11.6. So the thickness will be 11.6. And if you multiply that into 150 minus 11.6 by 2, so the 11.6 by 2 will be the center of the flange. So from the center of the flange to the y axis will be 11.6 by 2. So if you find this area into this distance, you will be getting ZPY. After adding the three component, you will be getting ZPY of the top flange alone. So this is the difficult part in design of gantry girder, arriving the Z component for top and bottom. After getting the values, you can substitute here. So the formula is 1.2 TX. So Z at, this is elastic section modulus at tension. So the elastic section modulus at tension will be 3137 into 10 power 3. So 3137 into 10 power 3 into Fy is 250 divided by 1.1. Why we are dividing into 10 power 6 is we need the value in terms of kilonewton meter. And this value is called the moment carrying capacity, elastic moment carrying capacity. For plastic moment carrying capacity, we have to substitute ZPX. So we know ZPX will be, total ZPX will be 0.754 into 10 power 6. So you have substituted here and we got the plastic moment carrying capacity of 1080.5 kilonewton meter, which is greater than elastic moment carrying capacity. See, this is the concept of designing a structure. First, how a structure should fail. If you are designing any building or industry, first you should have some limitations to see that the structure is going to fail, and then there should be deflection of the beam and it should reach the hinge and then it should break. You should visually see the deflection of the beam, then after that it should progress to plastic stage and then it should go to the breaking stage. So this is the process of failure. So in order to make sure that the elastic moment carrying capacity is 855 kilonewton meter and plastic moment carrying capacity is more, so this structure is going to fail like this way. So if the structure reaches 855.5 kilonewton meter, the elastic range will cross, and after 1080.5 kilonewton meter, the section goes through the plastic range and then it will go to the breaking stage. So here we are checking the moment carrying capacity in plastic and elastic same way. So due to the horizontal load, the moment the y-axis comes into the part, and we have found the zy of the top flange is 587829. We are substituting the same value, and for zpy what we got is 795692. The same value we have substituted. Why we are finding these two things is, this girder is subjected to two types of load. One is vertical load and another load is horizontal load. So to carry the vertical load, the section modulus and the moment carrying capacity at x-axis is being identified, and to check the horizontal load, the y-axis moment of inertia is taken and section modulus is taken and found the moment carrying capacity at the compression direction. So using this interaction equation, that is md divided by mdx moment, what we arrived. So what is the total moment which is acting? We found out that maximum bending moment is 641. And what is the moment carrying capacity, that is elastic moment carrying capacity, we have to substitute. If you substitute this, you will be getting some value, and total horizontal force is 18, and total horizontal force carrying capacity, that is moment carrying capacity, is 160. If you divide this and add, you are getting 0.86, and which is lesser than 1. Hence we are safe for the horizontal and vertical moment. So this is important here to check. And next we shall check for shear. So the moment concept is over, and let us check for the shear capacity. While checking the shear capacity, the total vertical load is vertical shear force, which is 473.8. Due to the vertical load, we have taken of neglecting the drag force, and the shear carrying capacity of the structure what we designed is, the formula and guideline is given as per the class 8.41. The nominal plastic shear resistance under pure shear is given as AV FY divided by root 3. So AV is when we are taking hot rolled section. Currently we are assuming section from the properties, so it is a hot rolled section. And in the plate girder, we would have taken welded section. So currently we have to take hot rolled section, H into TW. H is the overall height of the I section. So 600 into 11.2, which is the thickness of the web, into Fy is 250 divided by root 3 into 1.1, that is gamma m, material safety. If you Find this, you will be getting 881.8 kilonewton. What is the force which is acting here is 473.8, which is the shear carrying capacity of the I section alone. Currently we have not considered the channel section. For I section alone, it is very much capable to take the shear. So that is why it is sufficient. The maximum shear force is 473.8. is lesser than 0.6 times the shear strength computed as, that is 0.6 into 881, 0.8 will be 529, so which is also greater than the force which is acting. Hence our section has shear carrying capacity without any reduction in moment capacity. Okay, and also we have to check the class 9.2, which says that combined shear and bending. If you are designing a section for shear and bending, what you should consider is no reduction in moment capacity of the section is necessary as long as the cross section is not subjected to higher shear force. So the reduction of moment carrying capacity is not required here. Why? Because our condition is the factor value of applied shear force is lesser than or equal to 60% of the shear strength of the section as given in 8.4. So for checking the shear strength, we can go for 8.4. So we have gone to 8.4 section, and for checking the moment carrying capacity may be taken as 8.2. So we will be checking the 8.2 section. So let us go to the section 8.2 for checking the flexural strength, that is bending strength. How to check that? Our design moment, the factor design moment M of a section in a beam due to external action shall satisfy M should be applied moment should be lesser than our design moment. So let us check our capacity of the structure. So how much moment this gantry girder can take up. So for laterally unsupported section, we know that the gantry girder is not supported laterally. You can check that there is no support here. See, at bottom you are having a hinge, and at the top you are not having any support, so it is not laterally supported. So hence you can go for the second condition. If laterally unsupported, what we can do is we have to find a design moment, that is MD's design moment, that is beta ZP FBD, that is plastic section modulus into FBD. Beta shall be taken as 1 for plastic and compact section. So we can go for 1, and ZP we already know that. Currently we need to find FBD. What do you mean by FBD is design bending compressive stress obtained as given below. So FBD is an additional equation which is given, that is bending stress reduction factor into Fy. Fy we know that 250 divided by gamma m, which is 1.1. We need to find bending stress reduction factor. How to find this? You are having the guideline of 1 divided by phi lt plus phi lt square minus lambda lt square power 0.5, should be lesser than or equal to 1. So let us find this condition and let us apply this equation to find MD, that is design moment carrying capacity. And also for finding critical moment carrying capacity, the following simplified equation may be used. This is also given in Codal book in 8.2.2.1. We can use the critical moment carrying capacity in a simplified way. Square EIY HF divided by 2LT. We know Young's modulus is 2 × 10⁵, and IY is IYY. We have combined IYY, we have already found out. Currently we will be taking 46.96 × 10⁶. This is the value which we are going to take. We are going to check the moment carrying capacity of the I section alone. If the I section alone has the capacity to bear the moment, then it is okay. The area of I section is 17038 and height of flange, the HF is center to center distance between the flanges. So flange center to center distance is 600 − 21.3, which will be the center to center distance between the flanges. And L suffix LT, so L suffix LT will be the effective length for lateral torsional buckling. So if you check the table here, so to find L suffix LT, if the section is fully restrained, warping is not restrained in both the flanges, you can take the condition as 1L. So currently we are taking this condition, which is the length of the gantry girder is 7500, so you are multiplying by 1, the same value you will be getting. And RY is the radius of gyration at Y direction and about weaker axis. We know the from the table you can get 52.5 mm, and thickness of the flange. So thickness of the flange is 21.3, and ZP, we know that plastic section, total plastic section modulus in the axis has 4.75 × 10⁶. So we have all the values. If you substitute that and simplify, you will be getting 1766 × 10⁶ Newton per mm square. So this is the critical moment carrying capacity. And after finding that, you can find lambda LT. How to find that? You are having formula the lambda LT, you are having formula of beta ZP FY divided by MCR. Currently we have found MCR, the remaining values we have to substitute. MCR we got it as 1766 × 10⁶, FY is 250 and ZP is 4.75 × 10⁶, and beta is 1. So if you substitute, you will be getting 0.673. So this is the value of lambda T. And what we need next, after finding lambda T, you can substitute the lambda T here. So, and we need phi LT. How to find phi LT? That is, we need to substitute in this equation. So here you need alpha LT. So how to find alpha LT is, for rolled steel section, which is given as 0.21. Currently we are designing rolled steel section, hence we can take alpha LT is 0.21. So we know alpha LT and lambda LT, we can find phi LT. So after getting the value phi LT and lambda LT, you can get the bending stress reduction factor. So which is the thing I have substituted here, phi LT and bending stress reduction factor. And we got this value of 0.86 and phi LT as 0.776. So if you substitute the value bending stress reduction factor into FY is 250 divided by 1.1, you will be getting 195.6 Newton per mm square. So after getting FBD, you can substitute in this design moment. So after substituting, you are getting 929.8 kilonewton meter of design bending stress only by the I section. So I section alone has the capacity of 929.8. So the moment which is acting due to all the forces is 641. So So it is far greater. So hence our section is safe. So the next section is, what we have done is shear check is being over and bending check is also done, and the capacity of the section also we have checked for the bending. Right now we can design for the weld. So you have to weld the channel section as well as the I section. So for that you can use this formula Q equal to, that is desirable shear capacity of weld is V AY divided by IX. So what do you mean by V is, that is the service vertical load. So we have the vertical load as 473.8 kilonewton, and A is the area of channel section which we are going to weld, and Y will be the top portion. In the top portion we are going to weld the section, that is why we are taking the weld is going to happen in only the top section. So we know the overall section is 600 minus 355.1, you will get the remaining distance. That is 244.9. Okay. Then IXX, we already know the IXX of the section. 113.7 × 10⁶. After substituting here, you can get the desirable shear capacity. It will be requiring a shear carrying capacity of 439 Newton per mm. So for each and every mm of the weld, 439 Newton or more than that is required to take care of the shear load. And we are adopting 3mm weld. If you provide 3mm weld, so what is this 270 is, you can check here that the ultimate tensile stress of 250, we are using a yield stress of 250. So in IS 800, tensile property of structural steel is given. So in that, the ultimate tensile stress carrying capacity starts from 270. So we can take this, and the ultimate stress carrying capacity into the size of weld is 3mm divided by root 3 into 1.25. This is gamma m. So from this code you can find this formula, and 1.25, which is the partial safety factor for the material if you are going for weld. So if you divide this, you will be getting 4.417 newton mm. So let us provide weld at both the direction. So the weld will be provided. So the section will be welded at 3mm at this point as well as this point. So you will be providing weld at both the direction. So if you provide that, you will be getting twice of the capacity. So nearly 834 Newton per mm strength you will be achieving through this weld, adopting 3mm continuous weld on both side of the flange of the girder connecting the channels. And the final step is check for deflection at service load. So only for service load we are checking. Earlier we have taken the total load. So what is the service load is maximum static wheel load. So per wheel load you are having 160 kilonewton, apart from impact load. So if you are substituting the 160 kilonewton here, and you can check that by using the I, what I we have provided for this structure is 113.7 × 10⁶ in IXX. So for provided moment of inertia, we shall check the maximum deflection. So the maximum deflection here is 8.7 mm, so which is lesser than 10 mm, which is the guideline, that is 7500 divided by 750. So hence it is safe under the deflection also. So we have nearly came to the end of the session, and this is quite a long session. But the complication here is, the load is not only vertical, the load is from lateral as well as longitudinal direction. We have checked for those eccentricity. So we had combined shear and bending force along this three directions and for the three loads. I hope you got the procedure to design a gantry girder. So this will be a challenging for a civil engineer. If you have this knowledge, you can tackle any kind of analysis and design complicated structure. I hope you enjoyed this session. Happy learning. See you again. Thank you.